You're listening to highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
All right. Now we have to plug your movie. So no trips down memory lane. You're a movie auteur now, Michael Meehan. So
yes,
we're going to talk about your art. Michael Meehan is a self-taught comic, painter, sculptor, writer, and now he's a movie auteur. His first film, Hey Monster, Hands Off... Sorry, I love this title. Hey Monster, Hands Off My City, just wrapped up a record-setting run at the Four Star Theater in San Francisco. Let me read you what Mick LaSalle from the San Francisco Chronicle says about Hey Monster, Hands Off My City, which you can now rent on Vimeo. This is what Mick LaSalle writes. Hey Monster is not a nostalgic look back, and it's not all about the laughs. This is a work of art made on a budget, a beautiful-looking movie with a particular sensibility that mixes absurdity and zany humor with sober concerns. Scene after scene impresses with its comic inventiveness, its arresting brand of lunacy. We get this completely bizarre element of a 15-foot furry spider roaming the city in the dead of night. And then there's this other idea at work, the notion that the city's real monsters are wearing suits. Welcome, Michael Meehan.
Thank you, David. It's so wonderful to be on your podcast.
San Francisco is where you're from, and you're joining us from San Francisco. You never left San Francisco.
I did not.
You did the Dennis Miller show when it was on the Tribune. This was back in 1992. And you killed. And Bernie Brillstein, who makes Stars, walked up to you and said, come, stay here, I'll make you a star. You just walked away from it because you're an artist who sticks to his vision. You have never compromised.
Very true, but I didn't compromise because I didn't know what I was doing. I certainly made foolish mistakes as well. So, but I did have a meeting with Bernie Brillstein and with Brad Gray, who eventually went on to run Paramount, and who actually just passed away this year.
Yeah, he did.
But, you know, he was the guy from The Sopranos. But they were asking me, like, well, what do you want to do? And I was like, I want to do a musical with Robert Mitchum and Christopher Walken. And, you know, I was like, that's what I want to do. When does that happen? When do we start? You know, I had no idea that all the other sort of manipulations and ass kissings that you had to do. So I didn't even have enough money to make it to the airport after the Dennis Miller show. I had to give the cab driver like all my money. And then I think I had like a radio and a tie.
So you are an incredibly talented artist. I go up to Kevin Rooney's house and I see these amazing paintings. Who did that? Michael Meehan. No, Michael Meehan's the brilliant comedian I started with back... Yeah, well, he's also a painter. He's also an actor, a writer, a poet, and now a filmmaker. This movie, Hey Monster, Hands Off My City, is based on a one-man play that you did in the Fringe Festival back in 2011. What Fringe Festival? Where was this done?
That was in San Francisco as well. I don't stray too far. And that was a fun show to do, and I just put it together, and I played about 8 characters. But, you know, that's like quick change. I was just pouring sweat by the end of it. But it was a good idea, which came out of just workshopping stuff. You know, as a comedian, you have tons of ideas that'll never see the stage. But this was an opportunity. Like, I was finally like, okay, I got to do something. So I took like this 8-week solo performance class with Charlie Varon at the Marsh Theater. And I was like, I just kept trying out crazy stuff. And it was funny because you're in a class with like, you know, 8 other people and like in an acting class. I remember you were talking about acting classes. You know, you, as comedians, you always want to land the laugh, you know, mug to the audience type of thing. I remember talking to you about that, you know. Mm-hmm. But this was just, I just kept coming up with more and more ideas. And I remember I got some great advice from Charlie Varon, because I did this joke. I said, how can cows speak of injustice if I order the beef lips? And Charlie Varon was like, some people aren't going to get that joke. Leave them behind. And it was just like the most greatest piece of advice of sort of like, yeah, just be yourself type of stuff. So out of that, the absurdity was able to get into the one-man show as well as the story. So I had to keep coming back. So I had to learn about making a story work. That was the absurdity and the jokes, that was all there. So I just had to sort of form it in and take out stuff and put in stuff. And that was just the process. But it was an eight-week
course taught by Charlie Varon, who I knew through Marty Higgins. Remind my audience who Charlie Varon is.
Charlie Varon did a solo show, Rush Limbaugh in Night School, which... Mm-hmm. Had a good run, and he did a couple other things, but as a teacher, he was phenomenal. He could really draw out, and it didn't matter who you were. And Marty Higgins, by the way, was another brilliant cat. I mean, oh my goodness. Mm-hmm. I always remember his speaking different languages bit. You know, he'd go,
Huevos Rancheros.
Yes, Huevos Rancheros.
The farm workers are saying hello. Huevos Rancheros.
Yes, yes. Is that an imaginary pickup truck? El Camino Real. El Camino Real.
I don't want to talk about Marty. It's too difficult because I was very, very... Do you see him at all? Do you speak to him?
I haven't seen Marty in forever.
Yeah, so I remember he took me to see Rush Limbaugh at Night School with Charlie Varon, and Charlie was brilliant. I remember this must have been, this had to have been more than 20 years ago.
Yeah, easily.
And I do remember going to see Eric Bogosian with Marty. And I like Eric.
Okay, yeah.
I like Eric Bogosian, okay? Nothing against him. I think he's very talented. This was 20 years ago. We were stand-up comics. We've had a lot of conversations on this show about Broadway plays and these $250 a seat laughs that really don't deserve laughs, but everybody paid $250 for their ticket, so they're going to laugh. And I've had a couple of friends who have been in Broadway plays, and I just want to stand up and scream, no, stop laughing. This is not funny. Stop it. Stop it. And Marty Higgins and our wives, we tried the couples night. We wanted to be normal. So we did a couples night, and we went to see Eric Bogosian. And it was pretty, I like Eric Bogosian, but when you're a stand-up comic watching some guy doing a one-man show and he starts doing the heroin addict, you know, you put the needle in your arm and you're seeing God and his face is melting into Jesus. And Marty screams, why? Why? And everybody turns around thinking Marty is so absorbed by the heroin addict. He's so moved. They think he's like that Eric Bogosian has moved Marty Higgins to scream, why is this guy doing this to himself? Even my then wife was glad that Marty did it. It was so bad. Marty was, you know. So, yeah, so you took the class with Charlie Varon, and so it took 8 weeks. And then how long did it take to, after you took the class, how long did it take you to write the one-man show?
I think the class in the spring, so about the summer, about 3 months in the summer, and then I put it up in early September.
Did you have a director?
Yeah, I had a director. I think Charlie helped me out a little bit, and then I had another guy, Kenny Jung, helped me out. with some stuff. So yeah, it was good to work with a director to sort of have me, have the objectivity of somebody else's eye. And they just kind of guided me a little bit. I made a set that I could fold down, and I had a bunch of stuff, because I'm always making stuff. I'm kind of, if that helps me out into get into a character. So I had like a suit that I could jump in it to play the mayor, Duché. Yeah. Ah, spelled douche. And so I gave cards to the audience. So during the press conference about the monster, audience members would ask about stuff, and I would, have all these answers, typical doublespeak stuff.
It's a play, and you were all the characters. You said seven or eight characters that you inhabited.
Yeah, so I played the monster, I played the mayor, I played the detective character who's trying to figure out what everything was. I played a couple of victims that are going about their business. I played his Irish neighbor who is always talking about how he got smacked in the balls, which is based on a carpenter, Irish carpenter I work with, this young kid, Ken, who was just so damn funny. He would just go, oh, he'd just be talking about people. Oh, they're farmers. They're farmers, And so the character, and Ken in real life would always cruise up in this truck that was like a glazier's truck that had no glass on it, but it was a glazier's truck with the same rave music playing. I think he had one rave tape, and he was always pulling up. But he was a hilarious character, so I was like, oh, my God. So I started imitating him, and he was saying, yeah, I see your man, George Bush, is doing things. Oh, I see your man, Harrison Ford's in a new movie. So I started imitating them, going, well, I see your man, Dr. Rene Richards. And you could insert, I see your man, Bruce Jenner, or Caitlyn Jenner is up to,
Dr. Rene Richards. You got to tell me, I haven't heard a Dr. Rene Richards. She was the tennis player who used to be a man, right?
Yes. some references go in deep, and they're there for good. Yeah. Dr. Rene Richards was one of those, because it was so bizarre. That was like 1980, right? Early 80s.
Yes. And but, so you did this one. We have to move on.
Moving along. And that's how I started the show too. Was I came out as a cop with the caution tape, the police line. That's how I started the show. All right, folks, show's over. Move along. Go on home. Show's over. Move on home. So
I have a theory about San Francisco, that the audiences there are no longer as politically correct as they used to be. The politically correct movement started in San Francisco in 1988. I remember it. I remember when it started. And it was 1988.
Yeah, it was the end of the Reagan era, and it was all over. Comedy was over. And, you were hilarious, because you would just get these audiences just to revolt against you. Hey, I'm pro-chick here.
But I think the audiences in San Francisco now have just given up. They've become so accepting that they're even accepting now of the Bobby Slaytons of the world. That they've moved beyond language. Do you find when you're doing like a Dr. Rene Richards joke up in San Francisco or Caitlyn Jenner, nobody's hissing the way they would, say, in, Tampa or Oklahoma?
Yeah, I mean, there's pockets of it. It depends on where you're playing. Some of the crappier clubs that I've been playing, they'll still give you a hiss, or they'll look at their phone or whatever. It's certainly, I think people were much more engaged. The internet has been a phenomenal distractor of attention. So you go to a show and people aren't as engaged in, like, you would go to a show to get the issues. You were a political comedian, so you would go and talk about issues, and people would get their information that way. But they'd get the laughs too, which now you get your, you know, your rundown on everything.
Is Hey Monster, let's talk about the movie.
Sure.
Okay, so you made the movie. You did it by yourself. Nobody came to you like Bernie Brillstein did and said, this is fantastic. Here's $20 million. Go make this movie. You believed in this piece. You knew it was good. And you made it on a, what do they say, shoestring budget? Is that what it's called?
Yeah, it was definitely a budget. Yes, it was a shoestring budget. For what we got enormous. I mean, it took like 4 years to make. Cost about $100,000.
That's a lot of money.
It's a lot of money, but if you break it down, it's $25,000 a year. It's like, okay, that's a doable sum, and that's what I did. Was
did you have a plan? Did you have a plan?
I had a vision, and then the plan filled that in. So then I'd have to get a plan. So what would happen?
Let's do this. Oh, hang on for one second. I don't want to get into the financials and the mechanics. Let's first talk about why people should see this movie. Tell me what it's about. We'll get to that in a second because, you know, how you did it. But I want to talk about who's in it. Kevin Meaney is in it. Michael Pritchard.
Bubbles Brown. Johnny Steele and Reggie Steele are some of the main characters.
Your mother?
Greg Proops is in it.
Greg Proops, your mother?
My mother-in-law. They're heavily armed grandmothers that cruise around looking for the monster. And Diane Amos, the pine saw lady, sings a rap song in the movie as the grannies are cruising around in a convertible Volkswagen with their AKs and whatnot.
What is the movie about?
The movie is about a monster that comes to the city. Well, the movie starts out in Romania where a monster eats a boy's mother, and then later he wheels into town on a unicycle, and it's present-day San Francisco, and now he's hunting the monster. In the meantime, a company has introduced a dangerous new drink called Crazy Cola, which is ravaging the city, and they've paid off the politicians, and no one's really concerned about the monster, but other people are tracking the monster, so it's creating panic, but also it's sort of two monsters at once terrorizing the city, and then it comes into a showdown at the end.
It sounds like it's a comedy horror film with a film noir bent.
Yeah, exactly. I would say yes. I'm learning how to pitch it and say things, but I'm still not really good at it. So I always...
Well, if Mick LaSalle gave you a great review in the Chronicle, you're doing something right. And we can all watch it on Vimeo right now, right?
Yes.
How do we do that?
You go to Hey Monster, Hands Off My City website, and then it's got a Vimeo link, and you can get it for... You can see for $3 or own it for $5.
Okay, and let's talk about some of the people who you put in the movie. Greg Proops was on last week, so a genius.
Well,
genius.
Yeah, total genius.
I
just ran into a woman who used to work with him when he was just doing stand-up, and he used to always try out his material on her. She said he was so funny, but Proops was hilariously fun, but we did a show at the other cafe, me, Proops, and Michael McShane, who's a phenomenal improvisational Shakespearean actor, comedian, and Kathy Sorbo, who was
The sympathy cards. Her and Nan were in the sympathy cards. I met them in Seattle, and they used to stay at my apartment when I was sleeping over at my then ex-wife as a girlfriend. When we were dating. I would sleep there, and they would stay at my place. Where is Kathy now?
She's still in Seattle. She's doing stuff up there. But we did a show together at the other cafe, the four of us, and so we came up with all these crazy... we came up with this... the heaviest a cappella band, Priest Fist, and we all did. There's no instruments. We were all just, you know. So that was a lot of fun. But one of the characters we came up with was Mr. Paranoid, and he was like a Wolfman Jack character, and there was conspiracies everywhere. But the catchphrase was, people would, you know, reel off a conspiracy, and then Mr. Paranoid would go, oh, it's bigger than that, baby. It's bigger than that. And then launch into a huge, even larger conspiracy. And so Greg Proops plays that character in the film. And then it's so funny. We filmed it in this bunker basement at my mom's house. And so it, you know, had all the survivalist stuff in there. But Proops was so funny. And then he just went on riffs, of course, that were just brilliant riffs, you know.
Let's talk about Michael Pritchard, who... If you're from San Francisco, Michael Pritchard, well, I don't want to embarrass him, but he's a saint. He truly is a saint.
Yeah, he's on a completely higher wavelength than everybody else. He opened for the Pope.
Yes.
When the Pope came to town. But not only that, he had to turn down Paul Newman because Paul Newman wanted him to work at his summer camp, and he goes, I can't. I got to open for the Pope that day. Which was a hilarious story, but
he blew the Pope off the stage because the Pope would have let him because the Pope would have let him blow him on the stage.
Follow that.
We haven't done Bobby Bitter for some reason. Yeah. Larry and I have not done Bobby Bitter on this show. I don't know. I'm worried that if we start doing Bobby Bitter on this show, it'll take off, and then I'll get caught in that web again.
Yeah, yes, yes. Oh, that was the funniest, the Bobby Bitter one. I mean, that was just...
Oh, that's a whole...
It was Forrest Gump before Forrest Gump existed.
Yeah, it was... Bobby Bitter was this aging... comedian who had done it all. He'd been everywhere. And I would interview Bobby Bitter. He had a telethon where he began. Do you remember the line? Barry Lang came up with this.
I don't remember the line, but.
You know, folks, cerebral palsy ain't as funny as it looks. We would go on Alex Bennett's show and do this, and it was just so offensive and so horrible. And people would come out to see it, and they'd stay for about 10 minutes and start walking out. And there'd be like three guys left who would be laughing hysterically.
Yeah. Right. It was definitely niche market comedy, but oh my God, it was hilarious.
All right, let's stay.
My Korean wife sucked.
Tell me who Michael Pritchard is, then we'll talk about Larry Brown and who else is in the movie.
Okay, Michael Pritchard was this huge 6'6", a Coke
he
machine
is.
With a head.
He is. He's still with
Johnny
us.
Johnny Carson show. Yes. Huge comedian and hilarious. He would take over the stage and just do incredible animal noises. And then he'd tell stories about being a probation officer for kids and do goofy stuff. And he won an Emmy on Taxi. He was this huge. He played a huge gay guy who dances with Judd Hirsch. Mm-hmm. This huge, you know, tango with him. It was just hilarious. And he's also saved a lot of comedians. And then he quit drinking. And then he also helped a lot of other people quit drinking and doing drugs.
Right. He's a Vietnam vet.
Vietnam vet. He's talked people off jumping off bridges. He's gone into drug dens and rescued people. I mean, it's just kind of a all-around superhero type of person.
If you want to know what he sounds like, listen to Cardinal Dolan. He's the is Dolan the Archbishop of New York City? I think so.
He was. I'm not sure.
I don't know if he's the Archbishop or the Cardinal. I think he's called Cardinal Dolan. Listen to Cardinal Dolan. That's what Michael Pritchard sounds like because they used to be friends. They grew up together. Did you know that?
Yeah. I didn't know that.
Yeah. Great guy. Any time I got into trouble, I'd call him. He would take care of it. You know? He just took care of us. You knew that if you got into any kind of trouble, Michael was there. He watched over the community.
He really did. He was unbelievable. And through that example, he passed it on. It was like, you know, and some people didn't get it, but there's a whole bunch of people who did. And, I remain his incredible friend today.
Yeah, you knew there was like a hierarchy when we were starting out. And there were certain high priests. Robin was God. And depending on how much trouble you were getting in, it would filter up. And then if it got really bad, right? And then Robin would take care of it.
Yeah.
You had to go through this ad hoc hierarchy of priests when you were messing up. And then if it got really bad, Robin would step in. I'm not trying to idealize this thing, but we had this thing of ours was...
We did. It was it was an incredible community. And I think they had the same sort of community in Boston as well.
Mm-hmm.
Before, you know, and it was an incredible thing. And I started in 1984, and it felt like I just jumped into this thing that was just like, oh my goodness, this is it, you know, and it was phenomenal.
Yeah, you had to buy into the premise, and the premise was Ma Irwin, right? There were certain, you know, Jeremy Kramer, Kevin, there were certain, you either bought into it or you didn't. If you didn't buy into it, you were passing through. But if you intended to stay there and be part of this community, you know, a lot wasn't expected of you other than just being decent. You didn't have to hang out every night, and you just had to be a decent human being and accept this system, the Dursts, and, you know, Jim, you had to be respectful of it. Like, it's like the pizzeria in The Sopranos.
Yes. There was certain, you had to fit into the protocol of it. And you know what's hilarious is the guy who didn't quite fit into all of that went on to become the biggest success, Rob Becker. who I just saw a couple of weeks ago. Dan St. Paul did a Holy City Zoo reunion show, and there was a ton of people for that. And Rob Becker popped into it, and it was hilarious to see him because it was like, oh, my God.
Yeah, there were people. I always felt I want to get back to the movie. I want to talk about San Francisco later. So tell us about Johnny Steele. Who is Johnny Steele, and what part does he play?
Johnny Steele is a hilariously sarcastic motor mouth comedian who he's an college football lineman guy, big, burly, just sharp-witted, hilarious, sarcastic. He plays Detective Steele, San Francisco homicide detective, and partnered with him is Reggie Steele, who's a big, tall, African-American.
He used to be an African-American.
He used to be an African American.
Okay, now he's just
black. American. Right. Back to his roots. But he's a hilarious cat as well. Together, because Reggie's much more laid back and soft spoken. So I worked with both these guys, and it was like when I started writing the thing, I was like, oh my goodness, these guys would be great together. And Johnny Steele was an impetus to get the movie going because he was going, hey, we're not going to make it. We're not the young bucks who are going to L.A. to make it. We got to get busy and do our own thing. And so that really motivated me. And so Johnny jumped on board, and he was phenomenal to work with because it didn't matter who was there. He would just be talking and just working on riffs and just, you know, talking and you know, just going on and on. Well, here's what Larry Brown should be doing. Here's what Bubbles Brown should be doing. You know, but hilarious.
Oh, when you were trying to direct, he was telling you how to direct?
No, no. He'd be talking to the camera crew. He'd be talking to whatever. And, like, the first scene that we filmed, and I'm filming without permits and just whatever. I'm just out there. But I'm up on the top of this hill in San Francisco, Golden Gate Heights, and we call it Turtle Hill. And it's just a big hill, overlooks the city, and there's nothing up there. And so I got Johnny Steele, Reggie Steele. I got a dead body. I got a crime scene crew. Johnny Steele has a documentary crew following him around. And I've got a couple camera guys, and we're all up there. And then this city inspector car pulls up, and we're like, oh, my God, we're busted. We can't do it. Oh, man. This scene, you know, there's probably 15 people there. And this guy gets out of the car. He walks around below us and then gets back in his car. And we're like, all right, let's shoot. Let's shoot this thing. And he was not interested in what we're doing. But for a moment, I thought we were totally screwed. But Johnny Steele was just so cool about everything. So he was a great guy to just be this, to follow him and Reggie through the movie to find out what's right. going on with the monster and everything.
So I should mention that the documentary crew following him around, I would assume they're Robert Campos and Tim Didion making the documentary Three Still Standing.
Absolutely.
Starring Will Durst, Larry Brown, and Johnny Steele. And that's a movie about the demise of the middle-class journeyman comic in the Bay Area.
That's it. And all those guys are in my film as well. So Will Durst plays Smokey, who runs Smokey's gym, the only gym for smokers. So,
Is Debbie in it?
Debbie's in it. She plays a in fact, Debbie's in it. We filmed this at Comedy Day. We got the whole audience at Comedy Day. We got a couple thousand people in, which was so awesome. Mm-hmm. But Debbie Durst was the city official going, you know, calm down, everyone. And then the whole crowd goes, we want answers. And then she's going, your city is taking care of you. And everyone in the crowd's going, what about the monster? And then, you know, so it was really cool. So Debbie played a city official trying to placate a couple thousand people. And then the character I played two roles, the guy in the mute assassin on the unicycle, and then I also played the TV reporter, Gweeb Simpson. And what I would do is I'd always just go to these events, like the Gay Pride Parade, and go, you know, it's a festive event here, blah, blah, blah. In other news, a mangled body's been found, and police are baffled. So, you know, I would just show up, whatever event. One of the gags we did in the film, which usually gets a pretty good laugh, is I showed up at the San Francisco half marathon, and so all these people are running behind me, and I'm there with the reporter outfit going, there's panic in the streets as citizens flee their homes, many in just their underwear.
great.
So it was always using stuff like that, and we ended up not even using a ton of those, but I was out all the time. You know, when the Blue Angels were over, I was, you know, doing that. And
they're bringing in the Air Force to fight the monster, that kind of stuff.
Yeah, exactly.
Great.
Yeah,
great.
So it was always just goofing on that type of stuff.
Sounds like a great way to make another movie. Just to use what's going on in the city and build a story around it. Let's go over some other people who are in the movie. Who is Kevin Meaney?
Kevin Meaney plays Mayor Duché, and he was just so hilarious. Yes, you know, and so we had this whole campaign. And Meany had come out from New York to play Vegas, and Ed got a hold of him, and so I got him a ticket from Vegas to San Francisco. So he came into town for a couple of days, and we shot a bunch of stuff, and he was just so hilarious. And we
so got does Mayor Duché not acknowledge that there's a problem?
Oh, yeah. No, he doesn't. He's just he's kind of like Trump was on the campaign thing of, like, you know, you can do whatever you want as long as you vote for me. You know, Duché with Duché. And so all these people are chanting, Duché, Duché.
And how do you spell the last name?
Yes, it's D-O-U-C-H-E. So it says douche, you know. And, you know,
the political ads are on TV. This city needs Douche, and this city needs Douche, and Mayor Douche is just the mayor for it.
To clean it out.
To clean it up. And so he's always up. So Meany was in town for only a couple days, but we got a ton of stuff. And, oh, my God, he was just so funny. And then so then we had more scenes with him, so we got him on the phone and we recorded some stuff. Because we had Dan Spencer, who his wife Rebecca Spencer was Robin Williams' personal assistant for, yeah, I don't know, 30 years or something.
Well, she,
but Dan's,
yeah,
very funny. Yeah.
Rebecca is the heart and soul of the San Francisco comedy scene.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, she'd be embarrassed.
If you can make her laugh, right, you knew that you were onto something.
You also had to be a good person. You also had to be a good person.
Yeah, you had to be a good person. Yeah. Yeah, you couldn't get on her bad list.
Yeah. She's like this. If Rebecca didn't approve of you as a person in the 80s, because we were all bad.
We moved to L.A.
Yeah, we were all bad. We were all bad boys, as I remember it.
Yeah.
But
well,
if
that
we
was the gig, you know.
And it was okay, but you had to behave when you came into the zoo or when Rebecca. This is, I'm not mythologizing. This is a fact. We were all bad, but there were certain people like Rebecca who you had to behave around. And if you didn't behave properly, you were shunned. Right?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. You're on the outs then. Forget it.
And we were all bad. We were all bad boys and girls.
Yes.
And troubled, you know, and unhappy and desperate. And it was all right to be that, but you had to treat people with respect. You could be unhappy. You could have outbursts, but you had to apologize. And you had to work on your act and be funny and work on being kind. You know, that I think, you know, San Francisco. Well, anyway, let's go back to the movie. Kevin Meany.
No, it was. Yeah. It's very true. It was about, you know, here's some behavioral rules that that will serve you well. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you get out of town.
Yeah. Not necessarily for show business, but for life.
Yeah. For just being a human being.
And
it didn't matter. Of course, like guys like Ken Samori, who were, you know, hilariously brilliant, but, you know, off stage, it was difficult to have a conversation with him. But he was also, he knew the rules, but he would show up. He always got stage time because he was funny. He followed things
right.
You know.
He knew the rules, and you, some people didn't, but you were supposed to treat him with respect because he was funny and he wasn't hurting anybody.
Yeah.
You couldn't be a bully if somebody,
yeah,
right?
No, you had to behave, like you said, but you know, within that parameter, you could be zany and wacky and do all kinds of crazy stuff, but you had to have you had the basic human skills of being nice to people, regardless of if you're a maniac on stage or not. You had to be able to be a human being that got along with other people.
And some of us, hang on for 1 second, we'll get to me. Some of us learned how to be human beings from the San Francisco comedy community. Some of us came to San Francisco from New York and knew that they were horrible human beings and broken. And San Francisco was basic training, where it broke you down and rebuilt you into a gentler, kinder, more social human being. You're a Marine, right?
I was in the Marine Corps, yeah. Marine Corps Reserve.
And they break you down,
six
right?
Beautiful years. They break you down.
What do they do to you?
Well, they yell at you and make you do all kinds of stuff for 3 months in boot camp, shave your head. And the first couple weeks, you're in shell shock. You're going, oh, my God, what did I do? How do I get out of here? There's a guy, right when it happened, he tried to get out by claiming he was a homosexual. And after 3 months, we, you know, went through training. And at the end, we're all like, hard charge of Marines. We're graduating, and he's just starting again with a new platoon, you know. So I was like, oh, my God, that guy just created his own living hell. Instead of just going through it and just, you know, accept they're going to break you down, and they're going to give you all the new stuff, and then here you go. And the Marine Corps was a perfect straight man for comedy. I mean, I learned so much from the Marine Corps about comedy as well, because they're very serious. But inside, I'm like, okay, yeah, this is good. And then once you get out in the world to a base or whatever, then you you have some more latitude.
You joined the Marines. Why?
Well, I was getting in a lot of trouble as a teenage punk, doing lots of stealing and vandalism. So,
really?
My father didn't trust me. Yeah. So my father didn't trust me. So this was a way to straighten the accounts up. I was like, I'm going to join the Marine Corps. But
was it his idea or yours?
No, it was my idea. I was like,
what kind of shape were you in? I know you smoked at the time. Were you smoking at the time?
Yeah.
Were you smoking during the Marine years?
Oh, yeah. I was in real good shape. But, yeah, you could smoke.
Were you an athlete before you joined the Marines?
Yeah, I mean, I played sports in high school, but I smoked in high school. I mean, we had a smoking square in our high school. The coach would take my cigarettes away before the game because he knew at halftime I'd run into the bushes and have a smoke at soccer games.
All right, so you join the Marines, and what are you thinking is going to happen?
Well, it's going to straighten me out, like you said.
And that was your choice, so you knew you needed to be straightened out.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Okay, that's interesting.
And it was also a proving ground. I was like, okay, I got to prove something to myself. I got to, you know, joining the Marine Corps is, it's almost the, in a way, it was like, okay, this is the easiest way to unscrew myself here is join the Marines because they kind of will take care of all the stuff that I need to do. I just have to go along with it. I don't have to go to the forest and get moral fortitude.
Okay, your first day in the Marines, what happens?
You come in, they tell you to, if you have any drugs, knives, guns, paraphernalia. Just, if you know what, exactly how it starts out in Full Metal Jacket, that's exactly how the Marine Corps boot camp starts out. They shave your head. They make you, you know, you have 20 guys around one faucet trying to shave your face. You're all nicked up. And then about, they're giving you your green outfits and a sea bag full of all the stuff you need. And they're yelling at you. And then at like 2 o'clock in the morning, you're in the bunk with 80 other guys rubbing your head that's just been shaved, and you're going, oh my God, what did I do? And then they yell at you for about a month straight where, you know, you're garbage, you're maggots, blah, blah, blah.
Do you begin to believe that?
No, you just learn how to respond faster. It's like, okay, this is what they want. And then everything you do is wrong, so they just keep messing with you. But then after a while, you kind of get it. So,
what do you mean you kind of get it? What do you mean you kind of get it?
Well, they march you for hours and hours and hours. So you learn how to march. So instead of screwing up, you learn how to do the maneuvers. And then you go up to the rifle range, and then you're up in the rifle range. And they teach you the first week how to clean your weapon, break it down, and everything else. And, of course, it's all wrong. So then they take you out into this fine red talcum powder up at Camp Pendleton and with your rifles, and you have to do, you know, jumping jacks and bends and thrusts and roll around the dirt. And you just get filthy. And then it's like, I want these weapons clean. So then you got to clean them again. And it's just over and over this sort of rote thing. But, you know, I went to Catholic schools. My dad was a combat vet from World War II, so it was somewhat familiar. I was like, oh, okay, I can deal with this.
Was it fun?
Yeah, then, I mean, it starts to get fun after a little bit. You start to get some sense of accomplishment, camaraderie for sure. You start getting some jokes going.
So MacArthur, you know, says the core, the core, the core. It's all about the core, the brotherhood, right?
Yes.
You stop being competitive, because you're all in it together, but are you enjoying other guys' weakness? I mean, do you enjoy when somebody falls by the wayside and can't do it? Do you feel bad that he's falling behind, or do you laugh at him?
Sometimes both, because I remember we'd be running, and we're not running that far. We're running a couple of miles, but this guys were just falling out that had never run really a lot. So they're, we had a ton of guys from the South too, and they're just, oh, sweet Jesus, save me, sweet Jesus, and you're just like, oh my God, and of course you're hurting and you want to be saying all that stuff, but just it's so funny,
What happens if you? What happens? You're running like 5 miles in the morning, right?
Yeah, I don't know if we ever ran 5 miles, but 3 miles was kind of the standard.
Did they wake you up in the middle of the night and say it's time to run?
Oh yeah, they would just turn on the lights and the yelling started immediately.
I mean, suppose you go, excuse me, I'll run in a second. I need to get a cup of coffee. I'd like to pee. And I don't want to do this on an empty stomach. I'm afraid of my hypoglycemia acting up.
Well, one time, and this was like, we had been in boot camp for like 2 months. I get up and it's early in the morning and I go in and take a leak. And one of the drill instructors is in the bathroom, shaving. And I go, oh, excuse me. And he goes, get your stinking, it just starts ripping into me. But I'm thinking, just a normal, polite thing of like, oh, excuse me, I just have to go to the bathroom here. Like, get your maggoty ass. But of course, in hindsight, you're laughing hysterically at that because it's just so funny. I mean,
well, what happens? Hang on for 1 second. So what happens? We've all experienced that moment where we see our high school teacher at the supermarket with his family, and you go, "Oh my God, he's henpecked and he's afraid of his kids." Did you ever see the DI later in that kind of situation? And is he polite? Does he smile and say, that was just an act? Or does he go back into the character? It's acting, right? Isn't it acting for a drill?
But they're hardcore. They are committed dudes. They don't break character. I mean, at the end, after you have been with them for 3 months, they'll begrudgingly give you like, all right, you're Marines now. Now go out there and go do it. But they stayed locked in, and we had a couple drill instructors that had to be like demoted because they were hitting privates and just, being extremely cruel. But it was just, hindsight, it was so stinking funny.
Are they sadists?
Oh, I'm sure some of them were sadists. We had one, and this was the guy, I think his name was Alvarez, but he got demoted from sergeant down to corporal, lost his drill instructor ship, and then was in charge of the laundry. So they busted him down a rank, but still kept him employed on the base. But he couldn't supervise training recruits to be Marines. And I don't know if he had to do some sort of probation, he got reinstated or whatever, but he would sit there and he'd say, at the end of night, you're all there in your white t-shirts and white boxer shorts in front of your bunk beds. And he's going, sing my song and make me starch my shorts, cause then we'd sing the Marine Corps hymn. And, but they would just come in and just call you all kinds of names. And,
let me ask you this. They call you all kinds of names. Were they politically incorrect?
Everybody was a maggot. Everybody was a effing dildos.
Were you called the F word? Did they question your sexuality?
Oh, yeah. I don't know if they still do that, but this was 1977, so.
Did they make fun of?
We're getting.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, they would say, are you queer for my gear? What are you looking at? You queer for my gear? Where are you from? Texas. Well, there's only two things in Texas.
I don't feel safe.
What are you?
I don't feel safe.
Yeah, I don't feel safe. Yeah.
What about, like, if did they make fun of Jews and blacks and Mexicans?
It wasn't really specifically that too much, because they are all, you're all just green. You're all green maggots. There's no color here. Everybody was just a green maggot. So in that way, it was very democratic. So you kind of all knew that you're in the same boat.
Right. Right. I always say,
but it was a perfect training ground. It was hilarious. In hindsight, it was some of the
boot
most
camp,
hilarious.
Yeah, boot camp is how long?
It's 3 months.
And what happens? What happens to your body after 3 months? Do you notice a complete change?
Yeah, you're in shape. I mean, guys that were really overweight would drop 50 pounds. I mean, these guys that were just this, you know, big old blubbery guys, they'd be slim and trim and beefy. And I put on 15 pounds because I was a real skinny kid. So it was good. I mean,
are you going to a weight room, or is it just the jogging and the push-ups and the calisthenics?
Oh, no. Yeah, it's just calisthenics and lugging stuff around and lots of running around and carrying stuff and, you know, push-ups, sit-ups, pull-ups, running. They would do is they would have everyone makes their bed, their racks, in this rack inspection, and then they'd come around, they'd find one thing wrong, and they'd go, they'd make you tear apart your entire everything and then bring it all into the front where they called it the classroom. So you bring in all, you know, 50, you know, 80 sheets, 80 blankets, 80 foot lockers, dump out everything from the foot lockers. And then they go, I want this place squared away. And then then you're just running around, you know, and you're just pouring sweat and you're just trying to make the beds and do it again and again. So, but my brother Howard joined a year later, and Howard became the secretary of the platoon, which follows around the drill instructor. And whatever drill is, you know, whatever recruit has a problem, he's like, secretary. And so, but Howard didn't know how to make his bed. And so their place would get torn up. Eventually, he just had somebody making his own bed. So the brilliance of my brother Howard is he joined the Marine Corps and he didn't have to make his bed.
The Meehan brothers were on, was it America's Got Talent, where you were doing an Irish rap? What show were you on? It was an NBC show.
That was Last Comic Standing.
That was one of the funniest things. I remember you sent it to me and I laughed hysterically. We're Irish rappers, right?
Yeah, yeah. We did this whole thing. The Irish Tanning Heroes is the piece. So we would just talk about brave men and women who went out into the sun and never came back. Who could forget? You know, and then we go on and on.
I took an acting class with your brother. He's a brilliant actor. Is he in the movie?
Yes, my brother Howard. He's in this small part. He plays a cop. He was busy doing a bunch of other stuff, but. My other brother, Chris, who is in the trio with me, he's got a bigger part. He plays a sort of a General Patton-esque scout leader who sends out my nephew, James. They weren't called Boy Scouts. We couldn't call them Boy Scouts, but we called them Urban Rangers. And so he has to get his scat badge. And so he follows the scat around, and he finds the monster scat. And then he doesn't know what it is, but he follows it around town and he finds the monster and befriends the monster. So,
Well, before you go, it's great to hear your voice and it stirs up memories.
Likewise, David.
Yeah, it stirs up memories. Is this a hate letter, a love letter, or both to San Francisco?
You know, it's a love letter, certainly for the city that we know and love. And a lot of it's sort of like, hey, you know, things are changing. And even some of the places we filmed started going away. So it's very nostalgic in that sense, but it's also sort of addresses sort of the way things are in cities, certainly the city of San Francisco, which is, you know, politicians are swayed by huge amounts of money and ignore the public good. So...
Is San Francisco, is it an unlivable city? If you're middle class, can you stay in San Francisco?
if you got deep roots and you got family and a place to live, you can make it, but you get assaulted, you know, all along the way by every sort of threat that you can, whether it's just trying to park or, I mean, all the people who are in the trades, so few of them live in the city anymore. There's no shops, you know, there's very few shops. Many, you know, before in the neighborhood, there'd always be, oh, there's a shop over here, the guy's making something over here. So, and that's very middle class profession. But I think everybody works downtown. They just, I don't know what people do now, mm-hmm. but they breezed off to some computer job, which is even a misnomer. I don't know what they do, some tech job.
Yeah, I get very upset when I think about San Francisco because it's a beautiful city and you get there and you're breathing pure oxygen and you're just surrounded by the ocean and the fog and it's just fantastic. And every rich kid and his parents want to live there. So it's just inundated yeah. with retirees who have money or trust fund babies who have money or the latest business fad. Now it's computers or social media and they just raise the rents. And if you don't have money, you can't live in San Francisco. When I moved to San Francisco 30 years ago, more than 30 years ago, I saw a whiff of it. I kept wondering, where do people work? I would walk around San Francisco and I didn't understand it. I go, it doesn't make sense. Why do these people have money? It never occurred to me that there was such a thing as inherited wealth or trust fund babies or retire, people who don't have to work. And I just go, well, how do they have the time and the money to go to a movie during the day, that kind of stuff. And now the whole city, it seems, is like that. It's tourists or people who are living there on permanent vacation. Whose fault is it? Whose fault is that?
It's Steve Jobs. He invented this phone that caused people to stop communicating face-to-face.
Like we're doing now.
That's exactly. Yes. Exactly. No, I mean, it was the massive tech came in and it was all about this innovation and that innovation. But then you just flush out all the cultural people that are holding things together. It's very San Francisco right now is kind of like Paris was in 1940 when the Germans invaded. Because all you see driving around are these gigantic German staff car Audi BMWs. People speak another language, and they're entitled, and they blow off the locals who wear berets or whatever. They get shipped mm-hmm. off to wherever they are. And then you have the indentured servants who drive around in the Uber Lyft cars, and they just block the roads.
And then there are the collaborators who think they can move up. But they're not going to.
Yeah.
Does it make you angry? Does it make you angry?
Yeah, you know, but I can't live angry. That's a crazy way to live. I mean, they screwed with the water. Hetch Hetchy, we stole that water 100 years ago. Now they're mixing it with groundwater, and it's a big campaign of like two sources are better. So it's like obvious BS. 1984 speak. Mm.
But, what is the before you, know, you go? What is the big issue now in San Francisco? Is it the water?
No, that's just a crime against nature and us. That's just one of the things. People say it's housing, but they're building these massive amounts of housing, and I don't know what the problem is other than they got rid of the old San Francisco and they replaced it with something not as good. Like in Men in Black, when the wife says, it's not the same Edgar. That's what San Francisco's like. It's like this alien creature that's disguised as San Francisco.
Hmm. Yeah. It Because
they don't have the historical reference. Everyone's skipping around like it's the latest fraternity hangout. You know, right. The amount of pinheads running around doing pub crawls. Who knows where they're from? They're not from here.
There's a great story.
But yeah.
I don't know if you remember Bobby Corona. He owned, what was the name of the club? It was a rock club. Anyway, he booked Chuck Berry. And Chuck Berry shows up, and he's about to go on. He says, give me my money. And Corona hands him a check. And Chuck Berry picks up the check and goes, this looks like money. It says it's money. But it don't smell like money. And he rips the check up, and he says, go get me my money. He had to go get cash. And so to me, I always think of that when I come to San Francisco, where I go, this looks like San Francisco. It sounds like San Francisco, but it don't smell like San Francisco. It's just not. And the audiences, the comedy audiences, if I were to fulfill a fantasy of leaving New York, moving to San Francisco, and becoming a born-again comic and start all over, where would I perform? Because there's Cobbs in the Punchline, but they're owned by Clear Channel or Live Nation.
Right.
Where do you go to work out? There's Mill Valley, but where do you go to work out every night? Are there places?
Yeah, I mean, there's tons of open mics, but there's not money like it was back in the day when you could actually, you know, supplement or kind of make a stab at making a living. You know, we do a show with Johnny Steele, Stephen Pearl, and Larry Bubbles Brown. We call it the Dinosaurs of Comedy. And we work the Punchline maybe 3 or 4 times a year. And the crowds that come out for it are awesome. But it's generally an older crowd. You know, we get some younger kids in there for sure. But it's a raucous, great show because we've all been doing comedy for 30-plus years. So it's joke, 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 joke. You know, we're not just going up with an attitude about this and that. You know, we're attacking with premises and punchlines and a lot of deep bench humor. And it's so fun to do that and then to connect with the crowd. And the crowd's like that over at the Throckmorton in Mill Valley, too. So, you know, it's the crowds are a little more.
Is there an explosion? There's an explosion. Everybody's a stand-up comic now. Is there an explosion in San Francisco the way there is in New York and L.A. where everybody's getting up?
Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah, everyone. And, you know, if you're tech savvy, you rally your people to come to a show. And I hate to be like some of those grumpy old comics that have missed the boat. You know, why I did this and this. But I remember, you know, you'd see a young guy that was really tearing it up. You're like, oh, my God, that's so damn funny. And then you'd see somebody else. But I haven't seen... I see so much more comedy done with profanity, and that's sort of the language that's acceptable. And it's like you take away all that profanity and you really, you know, you have a couple of personal experiences. That's about it. No great premise. Never, you know, guys like Jeremy Cramey were just crack the sky open and, you know, a new idea would come down and, you know, 20 comics to go jump on that new idea and make their own spinoff from it.
Go on about the profanity, because I ran into trouble with a lot of young San Francisco comics because when I played the Punchline, they weren't allowed to say the F word, and a lot of guys got really pissed off at me.
I think it's a creative plus to not say the F word. If you take you take the F bomb out of your act, and your act's not funny, you're not funny. You're just being, you know, you're just kind of being stupid. But if you really craft a joke and you make it work and you sell it without profanity, that's craftsmanship. And that's how you do it. That's how you write a good joke. I don't see the mentorship that we got. We certainly, we got so much mentorship because we saw older
established comics go up there and slay with unbelievable material, and then you're like, oh, that's where I want to go.
Mm-hmm.
I don't see that with the profanity of young comics or even older comics that use tons of profanity. It's like there's nothing to be learned there other than like, oh, hey, this works. You know, hit them over the head with a sledgehammer.
Uh-huh.
They love that.
I have this compliment that I give to comics. I'll walk into a club, and if I hear the profanity, I don't want to be a comedian. I don't want to play to that audience. I hear them laughing at profanity, and I go, yeah. I want to go home. I don't want to get up now because I'm not famous, and I have to go work this crowd, and they've been poisoned. And then when I see an act,
it's true.
When they're working to their better angels, I say to myself, wow, I want to be a comic. But the greatest compliment I can give a fellow comic is watching them and say, you make me want to be a comic.
Yeah, yeah.
When I see somebody being vulgar, I just say, this is a strip show. I might as well just go watch a live sex act. And I've seen that happen. There was a club that I used to play in Austin. And eventually, they started bringing in strippers to watch the shows and their pimps. And then I look in the paper, what happened to the club? It turned into a strip joint. You know, and then they have male strippers, you know, Thunder Down Under's playing here. I don't want to, you know, I don't mind starting out in a strip club, but when you've been doing it for a while, it would be nice to play to an audience that expects something that's been thought out. Well, Michael Meehan, how do people, I would assume you don't have Twitter, right?
You know, I have it, but I never use it. I don't spend any time doing any of that. My sister set it up for me, but I don't know how to use it. I mean, I'm definitely a caveman.
Do you ever feel pressured to do that kind of stuff? I mean, is there, it just doesn't nag at you the way it nags at other people. Since I've known you in the early 80s, everybody was hustling. They wanted to be funny, but for a reason. You just wanted to be funny and good. You are a painter and a poet. You're the Pompetus of love. Do you not that self-promotion stuff that's, especially in San Francisco, when we were starting out, being a self-promoter was, people disdained that, right?
Yes, yeah. People went far. Now they have huge mansions in Beverly Hills, but they're not happy.
Right. No, but we were told you had to be funny. That's all that mattered.
Yeah, and I still think that's true on a base level. I mean, I enjoy being funny. I can be funny in just about any situation. That's a gift for me. You mm-hmm. know, it's like, hey, this is a gift. You know, I accepted at a certain point. It was like, oh, okay, I accept this. You know, I remember scoffing, hearing someone said, oh, it takes courage to be an artist. And I would scoff at that going, bullshit. Here I am using profanity. But then I realized, oh, if you have a gift, you just have to use it and not be afraid to use it. And it's like that with funny. You're funny. David Feldman, very funny person. I think of your bits and I laugh. Other people who are comedians who I think about, I laugh. They're funny people. They say funny things. They come up with funny things. That's a gift. So doing that,
I was never, but you know, here's the thing. It's very nice. It's a great comment. But I was never as funny as you. We would drive to a gig, and I was this constipated bricklayer. Here's a joke. Here's another joke. I'm going to slap some cement around it and lay this brick. Here's another brick. You would just ooze comedy all the time. And I was the guy, save it for the stage. I'm that kind of guy. I wasn't that much fun to be around. You're just always funny, always looking for the laughs. You live your life being funny. I'm more of, I always think, like, you know, I'm calculated. Oh, that's a funny idea. I'm going to write that down. You know? But you kind of lived and breathed it. Like Kevin Rooney, for example. Where you just can't help yourself but be funny all the time.
Yeah, Rooney is just, in fact, I went down with my son and my wife to see Rooney last year, and he was just goofing on a joke. Well, my son, who was 8 at the time, picked it up, and now he does the Rooney bits, you know, mm-hmm. that Rooney was just talking about his condition, you know, that, oh, I do something and I can't do it. It's like, oh, there's a $100 bill, I'm going to reach for it. Oh, I can't quite reach it. Well, my son's doing that around the house. He's doing Rooney bits. So,
mine
I mean,
too. He had a profound effect on my kids. I mean, I can't even, I remember, oh my God, I shouldn't, well, Kevin Rooney is the most literate, profane
yes.
human being on the planet. I mean, he goes high and low in a way that just, I can't even yeah. repeat half the things. But I don't know if I should tell this story, but I will. I can't do it. I'll have to tell you. It involves, yeah, I can't do it. Michael Meehan, your movie is called Hey Monster.
Hey Monster, Hamster. Hands off my city.
Hands off my city, and we can watch it on Vimeo, and then I assume it's going to be streaming wherever, right?
Yeah, so you can get it on Vimeo, and, you know, eventually I may get some sort of distribution thing happening for it, and it may play in some other markets, cities, even whatevers, maybe even another streaming service. And then enter into the pantheon of films that people go, oh, yeah, that was a funny film. Because the response I got, and this is a small sample, plus it's very local, but people seem to enjoy the movie. So that was always a good sign.
Yes, and it got great reviews. I will tell you this. My daughter and son and their friends were like 10, 12, and Kevin Rooney came up with a euphemism for a vagina, calling it the moojma. And he started telling my kids about how Santa Claus, if you're a good kid, Santa Claus slides down your moojma and leaves little gifts. And we were laughing. I mean, there were adults there just on the floor laughing in front of 10-year-olds and 12-year-olds. He never said vagina, but he would just tell
right.
He'd say, you have to take care of your moojma because that's where Santa Claus likes to slide down. And you don't want him to leave coal in your moojma. And so then, you know, for 5 years, all the kids in the neighborhood are talking about their moojmas, but they don't know what a moojma is.
Yeah, yeah.
but your kids
know where the source.
They know that we were laughing at the word moojma, and Kevin Rooney made up the word moojma. So there's no way the kids' parents can say, you know, my child was over at your house and he learned the word moojma. I don't think that's appropriate. I mean, it was just genius on Kevin Rooney's part because he would be saying, kids, make sure to take care of your moojma.
No, Rooney is just so damn funny. I mean, he's right up there with Robin Williams as far as just an endless genius supply of just the riffs.
There's a look that I saw in what I used to love, and it makes me feel young, is I would sit next to Kevin Rooney, just like at the Comedy Magic Club, just go down to drive down to the Comedy Magic Club, and he would hold court, and Jay Leno would be there, or Dennis Miller, or Bill Maher, and they all had the same look in their eyes. They all deferred to Kevin Rooney. And they all had just this awe. And that was the other thing that I loved. I knew my place at the table. I knew that I was sitting with the adults, and I'm just going to sit here. I don't have to say anything. I just have to listen. And anyway, I miss those days where getting to sit at the adults' table. I love you, buddy. we'll do this again, I hope.
David, I love you too. Thank you so much. I'd love to. Yeah, we could talk endlessly and bore people to tears with everything. But thank you so much. It's a real pleasure, and I love your podcast. You're just phenomenal. So,
hey, say hello to your mom and stay on the line for 1 second, okay?
Sure.
You're listening to highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.